Page 68. Today, we will be learning inside that which we spoke last week outside. As a quickly recap, we spoke about the idea of the struggle that a person has against the Nefesh HaBehemes, and how this struggle isn't restricted only to areas of Isur V'Heter, you know, that the struggle not to do that which the Torah says that you're not allowed to do, or the struggle to do the things that the Torah says that we must do, but the struggle is constantly, it's ongoing, that we're supposed to be on guard. And the idea of Iskafia is that when you want to do something, delay the gratification, because our life is supposed to be L'Shem Shamayim. We're supposed to be operating out of the place of the Nefesh HaLikis to serve Hashem. And every single time that we suppress our desires and we don't do them, so that causes a tremendous nachas above, as explained earlier in the Perek. And we're going to do inside. And we're going to start from V'loy Oid, which is page 68.
Yeah.
Amen. Around 13 lines in the top. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. No. 10 lines in the top. Ve'lo yoyin, moreover, Allah afilu b'dvar mamutam l'gamri. Even things, even in matters that are completely permissible. Kol masha adam zeveich yitzrei. Whatever a person sacrifices is yitzer. Afilu shakali, even if it's a temporary sacrifice. In other words, delaying, not that the person is not going to do it, that which he wants, but he pushes it off. Afilo shah kala, even temporarily, umiskaven, with the intention, the person is delaying with intention. Lakfaya lo sita achra, to suppress the sita achra, shemechal las mali, which is in the left side of the heart. Kagain, for example. Shechaf it's lachel, a person wants to eat, umacher sudasai, and delays his meal, ad laacher shah, for an hour, a pachis, or less. Vaisik b'teira vaisa shah, and steady studies teira during that time. In other words, not that the person doesn't eat, but instead indulges some sort of other gratification, but the person, instead of eating, indulges the nefesh alikis, learns teira. Kedisa b'gemara, as the Gemara says, Shah Revius Michael Kaladam, the fourth hour. We spoke about this last week. That in the olden times the average person ate breakfast in the fourth hour of the day. And Shah Shishis, the sixth hour, is Michael Talmidei Chachamim, is when Talmidei Chachamim would eat. V'hoyu mar'ivim asmam shtei shoyis l'kavanazu. They would go hungry for 2 hours for this purpose. Even though shigam acher asuda hayolimdim kol yom, also after the meal they would learn the entire day. So it's not as if they gained time for learning by eating later, but it's simply for the purpose of iskafia.
What's the point? Find a solution.
Sorry.
What's the point
of delaying the meal? The point of delaying the meal is exactly what he's saying: is that if the Nefesh HaBehemes, if I want to eat right now, so I won't eat right now. It's a way of showing who's the boss. That I'm eating to serve the Eberster, so I can go hungry for a little. Now, it also goes without saying that if this is going to negatively impact one's Lumad HaTorah, then that's not a good thing.
For your schlag.
So the Gemara says, what?
You need the food for your more energy, have a sharp effect.
Right. The Gemara says that if a Talmud Chacham fasts and that causes we're talking about you know, an optional fast to be holy or for tshuva, and that causes that there's learning to be impacted. According to the Gemara, such a person is called a choita, a sinner. So obviously these people they're able to evaluate in themselves and realize that not eating these 2 hours is not going to negatively impact the learning. But on the other hand, it's a way of showing who is control. Way of showing the control. Right now I want to eat, but I could wait for an hour, so I'll be a little hungry. It's fine. Why do I want to eat right now? That's because my nefesh Bahamas wants. Why do I need to eat l'shem shamayim? So I can wait for a little. It's a way of, whenever you want something, and who is the you? Who is the you? The you is the nefesh Bahamas, the soul, you know, the self-interest. Again, there's nothing wrong with you. We're not talking about something wrong, and we're not even talking about something which is extra or luxurious, but every time I want something and I say, no, I'm not going to do it. That is the chiddush of the Peirik over here is that the I that wants is Sitra Achra. I know that sounds very, very extreme.
Such a thing that Lloyd Dyke must ask for the Torah.
Sorry?
Such a thing that it's not what the Torah asks, they don't put the extra seed in, no?
Like, there is definitely Lloyd Dyke must ask for the Torah.
Right.
It's a shaykh, the Maimar Chazal, that it says the Nazir is punished for not drinking wine. Why? Because Leid Dayacha, it's not enough for the Torah Asers, you have to go eat, deny yourself something else also. That's true. On the other hand, in the Darim, Siyag Leprishus, there's a mile in the Darim. So it's a double-edged sword. And the question is, Vuma Halten Avedas Hashem? Sometimes, in a Hanami, it can bring to a Kilkul if it's done wrong. But if it's done right, it has to be. But also, we're not here, it's not about Sha'asar Lecha Teira. We're not saying don't eat. You will eat. You'll eat in 10 minutes, and 15 minutes, and an hour. In other words, how much can you push it off without you being negatively impacted? I want to eat right now. Okay. If you recognize that your eye is Sitr Akhra, and again, what does Sitr Akhra mean? We think of Sitr Akhra, we usually conjure, pictures of the Satan, right? Yeah. But the way the Alter Rebbe defines Sitr Akhra means anything that's other than Kedusha. Kedusha is Bittul Dashem. Anything that is ego, that is self, is Sitr Akhra. It's the other side of Kedusha. So the I that wants is not Kedusha. The I that wants to eat it, if I want to eat for a Kedusha Dikr reason, then that's not a problem. But if I want to eat because I'm hungry and I want to eat, that's a Sitr Akhra desire. When I go say, no, I'm not going to eat right now, what I'm doing right now is suppressing the Sitr Akhra. Suppressing the Sitr Akhra down here has an impact that it also caused the Sitr Akhra to be suppressed above. The I is Sitr Akhra. Yeah?
Suppose I could eat a little bit and it's not disturbing my learning one bit. I'm sitting with the Gemara, so I take a bite of a cracker, piece of glass of tea, I'm learning, it's not disturbing my learning. Is that part of this case?
Yeah. Your question is because you're not grasping the concept. It's not that there's anything wrong with eating. If there was anything wrong with eating, that wouldn't be the part of the conversation. If it was disturbing your learning, that's a different conversation. We're befeir is talking about over here something which is absolutely innocent and innocuous. There's nothing wrong with it. But why do you want it? And again, we're not saying don't push it off for 2 minutes. What you're doing at that time is that you're focusing on the idea that it's not about what I want, it's about what Hashem wants. When I need to eat, I'll eat. When I need to eat what to serve Hashem, I'm going to eat. But right now, it's just because I want, so I don't need to.
That's human nature, not that they want to eat. It's not
Shabbos, human nature is Sitra Akhra, that's the point. That's not... We had the last, in earlier in this Peirik, that by the Beinoni, in other words, the struggle, the person not the tzaddik, that is who are the matzmai. It's not here. It's Peirik Haftas. Your desires are what? That's not Kedusha. Your Kedusha desires are to daven and to learn. When you want to eat, it's because I want to eat. When I want to eat, it's because I want to eat. That's not Kedusha. So by me delaying it and saying it, I'm not going to eat right now. I know I need to eat. Why do I need to eat? I need to eat l'shem shemayim. But right now, that's not why I'm eating. Right now, I'm eating because I want to eat. No. I'm going to wait. And in 2 minutes, I'll have more focus and I'm going to eat it than l'shem shemayim. Not because I want to. And again, this is a hard concept to get, but this takes us back to what we spoke about last week. If we realize that at any moment, we can be receiving our energy. We can be plugged into one of two places. Nefesh al-Kisra and Nefesh al-Bahamas. When I do something because I want to do it, it's not evil, it's not bad, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's Nefesh al-Bahamas, it's not Nefesh al-Kis. Nefesh al-Kis is when I do something because the Eibishter wants me to do it. Do I want to be plugged into my Nefesh al-Bahamas? If I want to eat right now, I want to have that cracker right now, And if I eat it, I didn't do anything wrong, I didn't do any avera, I won't be punished for it. But at that moment, when I indulged my desire, I right now was plugged into Klipan Sitra Achra. I don't want to be plugged in there. I don't want to be plugged into my Nefesh Elokeis. I'm going to say, not right now. Right now, I want it. Good. I need to eat. Why? Because I need to serve Hashem. That I'll do in 5 minutes. Not the moment that I want it, because that's a full expression of the Nefesh Bahamas. So when I do that iskafia, when I suppress my Nefesh Bahamas in the Klipa, that causes a suppression of Klipa above and gives incredible pleasure to Hashem, as discussed earlier on in this parak. Yes?
May a person say, if I do, as the Rav just suggested, I'm feeding my Nefesh Elokeis?
Are you being honest?
Let's say I say to myself, I'm pushing it off. I don't want to feed my Nefesh Bahamas. Can I say I'm feeding my Nefesh Elokeis?
Are you being honest?
Yeah, I'm really.
You didn't say that with a lot of conviction. Yeah.
I'm asking, is it? But I don't know. Is it a concept? Is it an acceptable feeling?
When we eat, it's l'shem shemayim. L'shem shemayim means because I need the energy, because I need a daven, because I need to learn, because I need to serve Hashem. And that's what you call feeding your nefesh elokeis. Yes. But is that honest? Is that why you're eating right now? And again, the key here isn't not to eat. The key here also isn't to eat less. This is Chassidus is not into tainius v'sigufim. Is not into asceticism and being a parish and staying away from Elam Haza and all that thing. It's not about that. There's nothing wrong with the food. There's something wrong with me right now. So put it on hold for a second. Put it on hold for a second, a minute, 2 minutes. As Altareba says, I feel l'sha kala. And reorient yourself during that time. I want something? No, so I'm not going to. Why? Because me wanting is not a reason to have. Me wanting is a reason of the Nefesh Bahamas to indulge. Not Nefesh Elokeis. Let me stop a second. What?
If you really don't need it now.
If I really don't need it for Avedis Hashem, then Bechlal I shouldn't be having. But I'm talking about even something which is for Avedis Hashem. And even so,
you can push it off.
Not the moment that I want it.
Yeah, all right.
V'chein, similarly, b'ilim, piv. It's going to get harder. A person who closes his mouth, shuts his mouth, miladaber dvarim shalibim, misabav ma'id ladabram, from talking things which he really wants to speak. Minyana yo'ilam. I think this is a bigger temptation, a bigger nisoyan than not eating. In the middle of a conversation, you want to speak. Why do you want to? Is it important to speak? Do you have to say it? No, but you want to. We're in a conversation.
Enjoy it.
Enjoying the conversation. Who's enjoying the conversation?
Self-gratification.
Is you Nefesh Elokeis, Nefesh Bahamas? Nefesh Bahamas, so don't say it. We're not talking about Lashon Hara, we're not talking about Rechilus. Talking about something which is 100% mutter to talk about. The fact that you want to, suppress your Nefesh Bahamas. And now it gets even harder. V'chein b'irhuri machshavte. Now, how about in your thoughts? Right? You're thinking something, you're enjoying it. Don't think about it. I feel this is so counterintuitive because we usually approach Yiddishkeit. What am I allowed to do? What am I not allowed to do? This I'm not allowed to do, this I stay away from. Remember we spoke last week in the Velt. Vasmatarnish tarmanish, that which you're not allowed to do, you're not allowed to do. And last week I said the Bechsidim is a vart. The Chsidim they say Vasmatarnish tarmanish, what you're not allowed to do. You're not allowed to do, and thus men meg, and that which you're allowed to do, dachmanish, you don't need to do it, right? Which is a very big shift in the way of thinking. It really changes the entire battlefield. It's not about mutter or usser. It's not about good or bad. It's about nefesh elokeis versus nefesh bahamas. I want to be a godly person, not a self-centered person. Self-centered means that whatever I do, not whatever, but what I do is dictated by what I want. And that's really nice. To do whatever I want is nice. But that's so small. And that's so. Then I become a small and insignificant person, as we discussed last week. I'm just living to gratify my desires, even if those desires are mutter. And then there's a higher mode of living, which means that I understand that Hashem put me down here to struggle, and my job is to make sure that I'm at all times, or as much to the degree possible, I am channeling my Nefesh Elokeis, I'm doing what Hashem wants. Which means by definition, if I want, I'm not doing it if it's not necessary. So, So again, the same thing is when it comes to thoughts. And I feel even if it's a very small little. Which is interesting, Dr. Rebbe stresses this twice. Earlier also he says, afilu shah kala, even a small, a delaying, even a small amount of time. And here also, in your mind, even controlling your mind, even a little. You know, don't think that you have to, you know, delay eating by 3 hours. Don't think that you would, a little, every little thing that you do, that you want to, and you say, no, I don't need to do it. The skafya sitra achra lasata, by doing that, you suppress the sitra achra down here, and istalak yikara dukuchabrihu ukdushasai. And we cause a revelation of the glory of Hashem and Hashem's holiness, le'ela, in the upper worlds, harba, very, very much. And now we're going to learn that there's a side benefit to iskafia. When we do iskafia, when we suppress the sitra achra below, so as we learned, we cause a reciprocal effect above, and we cause that the sitra achra above is suppressed, and that causes a revelation of godliness. And the person who does that iskafia, the person who suppresses his nefesh habahamis, is the primary beneficiary of that revelation of kedusha above. Let's do this inside. From this holiness which we unleash above, we draw down an incredible kedusha on the person down here. Listen to these next words. And this gives him a tremendous siyua, help, assistance in his avodah. Think into that. You want to think. You want to think something. You want to say something. You want to eat something, and you don't, or you delay it. I feel the matmazer. He says even a little. You should know that when you do that, the kedusha that you unleash above trickles down to you, and the result is that that helps you and gives you assistance in your avodah. Your avodah from here on will be easier. Talk about an incentive. It's an amazing incentive. Alter Rebbe says, a little iskafia, every time you do iskafia, your avodah, your work becomes easier. The struggle becomes a little less. V'zeh oshamar razal. And this is what Chazal tell us, adam mekadesh atzme miat lamata, that if a person sanctifies himself a little down here, and what does it mean to sanctify? This is the definition of to sanctify. To be holy. What does it mean to be holy? Separate from the ilam hazeh. In other words, not doing what you want and when you want, but being holy.
That's not bittul.
It is bittul, but the result is that you're making yourself holy. In other words, by definition, I think we spoke about this. When the Ramban says,
Kedoshim
to you. What does the Ramban say? What does Kedoshim to you mean? We spoke about this last week.
Yeah, the Rashi, but the Rashi says.
No, the Ramban argues with the Rashi.
No argument, but what Ramban says.
Yeah. Right. What?
Kash Asman, the
Novel Bershus Satayr, we spoke about this last week?
No.
And the Pasuk, Kedoshim to you, which is the next week's Parsha, right? Next week's Achri Kedoshim. So the Ramban asks, what does it mean to be holy? We have all the mitzvahs, we have to do all the mitzvahs, we're not allowed to do all the averis. So by definition, if you do mitzvahs, you're holy, and as long as you do the mitzvahs and stay away from averis. Says the Ramban, no, there's a new mitzvah of Kedoshim to you. According to the Ramban, it's a...
What does Rashi say?
Rashi says that have a prushim arayis, like they call makim, anytime that you find the... you get the arayis, you see the word kedusha. So according to Rashi, it's like a continuation, it's not independent. Because we just finished in Parshas Achrei, we finished the idea of Kedoshim, of Arayis. Yeah. But according to Ramban, it's an independent thing. He says, no, there's a new mitzvah, which is Kedoshim to you, after all the other mitzvahs. According to Ramban, it's one of the 613 mitzvahs. And there's minyan mitzvahs.
You would be, you do a mitzvah.
Mitzvah mitzvahsim in Atoira, yes. He says, right, we'll get to that in a second. So Ramban says that since we just finished the halachas in Shmini and Tazriya Metzaira, we finished the halachas of kashrus, and we finished halachas also in Achrei, the halachas of arayis, of forbidden relationships, so one could say, okay, so I will not eat anything in non-kosher, and I'm not going to have any forbidden relationships, but I am going to fress meat and drink wine all day, kosher meat and kosher wine, and I will have 9 wives, which is allowed according to the Torah, some, even though I'm not having any illicit relationships, but I'm living a completely materialistic and hedonistic lifestyle, completely, as they say, farzunken. I don't know if there's an English word for that. Farzunken in taivus and in oilam haza.
What? In geschmack.
Depravity.
Right, in depravity. Farzunken means sunk. Completely, says the Rambam that it's possible for someone to be, he uses the famous words, possibly a novel b'rishus ha-Torah, which means a low life, but fully within the parameters of halacha. Mm-hmm. I can keep halacha 100% and be a farshtunken, a low life. In other words, what? A grabyung, they say, you're right. To be someone, a unspiritual person, a completely, you know, materialistic magushim. So comes along the Torah and says, Kedoshim to you, the mitzvah, which is Kadesh Atzmacha b'mutar lach, that even in that which is mutter to you, you have to be holy. Which is very, which is the idea we're talking about right now. Yeah. So when a person makes himself a little holy down here, in other words, you're holy. Not, just because it's permitted doesn't mean I need it. Mikachin oisei harbam lamayla, from above, they sanctify you a lot. And that's the meaning. That when you act in a holy way, you become, from above, they make you a holier person, which makes it easier. That's the siyua. That's the assistance that you receive in your avodah, is that you actually become a holier person. You are pretending to be holy. Because when you do iskafia, you really want that whatever it is you want. You're just acting in a holy way. But when all the mekadesh atzmei me'at lamato, when a person acts, mekachin esi haba melamayla dan taka, they make you holier from above. And this levad, mashe mekayim mitzaseh shel Torah, this is besides the fact that you're mekayim mitzaseh in the Torah, as the Rabban says of v'yiskadishtem, v'chuluk shemekadesh atzmei me'muter loy, when a person sanctifies himself even in those areas that are permitted to him. And this is a pasuk in the end of Parsha Shmini. Last week's Parsha says, V'yiskadishtem v'yisam kedoshim. What does it mean, V'yiskadishtem v'yisam kedoshim? Isn't that a redundancy?
Double
lashon. It's a redundancy, right? Look at Rashi. Rashi takes answer. V'yiskadishtem. If you act holy down over here, V'yisam kedoshim l'maylon elam haba, you'll have a holy place waiting for you. Now, the Rebbe has a different way of looking at it. V'yiskadishtem v'chuluk shmekadesh asivim v'terloi. Pirush v'iskadishtam, and the meaning of the word iskadishtam, shetasu atzvam kadishtam. You're going to act in a holy way. Kaleimar, av shebemes eine kadish. You're not holy. You're not, what is holy? You're not removed, umuvd al masitra achra. You're not really holy. You want that that piece of meat, or you want that whatever it may be. You're acting that way. Ki betakva ugvurasa, kitul dasa b'chal asmali. Because your nefesh b'hamis is at full strength in your left side of your heart. But we're talking about a person who conquers the Yitzharo, Mekadosh Shatzmei, and sanctifies himself. So that's V'yiskadishtem. When you act holy, what's going to be the result? V'yiyisam kadoshim. You're going to end up, you're going to be holy. Kaleimer, Soifei li yiskadosh mudul bemes. You will be holy. That's the siyua. That's the assistance you get from above. You will takebi umudul bemes tzitarach. You'll be truly removed from tzitarachra. Aideshi mekachem esiharba melamayla. Because they sanctify you a lot from above, from heaven, and you receive assistance to be able to expel it from your heart, ma'at, ma'at, slowly but surely. Yes?
But that wouldn't make you a tzaddik? That's not the level of a tzaddik.
Right, we'll get there. So what the Rebbe is saying over here is that when you do iskafia, that when you suppress your nefesh ha-bahamis, the result is that eventually you get help from above to slowly but surely expel the sitra achra and become taka, a holy person. Not just to act holy, but to be holy.
Expel.
Sorry?
You said expel.
Expel the nefesh ha-bahamis. That's the word he uses. Legar shama libe, to expel it from the heart. Now, at the same time, at the same time that we learned last week, but earlier in the Perek, on page Lamed Dalet, around 10 lines from the bottom, L'chein al yipeh levadam alav l'yir levavim yoyi, the person should not be depressed. Gam im yiyeh kein kol yom av mohamazu, even if his entire life he's engaged in this battle. Ki ulai l'kach nivra, because maybe that's what you're created for. V'zei savedah, saying this is your avedah, like fayel sitar achra tamit, to always suppress sitar achra. So the answer, a very practical level, is the person who's the beinoni, in other words, the people, those who struggle, as opposed to the perfect person, the tzaddik, who doesn't struggle, these are people who their job in life is to struggle. They will always struggle. 99.9% of people in this world always struggle. That doesn't mean that you have to be like a hamster on a treadmill that's always struggling in the same area. Your struggles can change and they can become more subtle and more holy. We spoke about this last week, right? Your struggle can be not from steak to learning Gemara. That can be a struggle. As we spoke, right? Remember last week that you want to learn Gemara. As we advance in life, we don't stay, some struggles remain constant, but some struggles we graduate from. As we grow, I mean, I'm sure everyone sitting here around the table knows what I'm talking about and can look back at your life and say, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, this was a big struggle for me, and today, I've grown. That's not a struggle for me anymore, but I still struggle. The essence of the struggle is the struggle against the Nefesh HaBehemes, which means ego and self-interest, but that can take on many forms. So says, the Alter Rebbe is saying over here that when you do iskafya, you get help from above, and that help from above causes that you should become kaddish and muvdal, holy, but holy in a certain area. And then you struggle, and then if you do more iskafya, you'll get more help, you can become holy in another area. And as discussed on many occasions, we all have tzaddik parts to us, right? We talked about this. We have beinoni parts, we have parts of the areas we struggle, there are areas where we don't struggle. And, you know, we have different columns. Here's where I struggle and I fail. Those areas of my life. Here's where I struggle, but I'm good. Here's where I don't struggle anymore. And life is about moving things from one column to the next. From the area where I struggle and fail to the area where I struggle and I succeed, and then moving something from an area where I struggle and to an area where I don't struggle. But you're never going to get rid of the struggles. You're never going to move to a, where if you're a beinoni, if you have the neshama of a beinoni, you're never going to move to a place where your life is free of struggles, because that's not what Hashem wants. Hashem wants you to struggle. That's your avodah, unless you happen to have the neshama of a tzaddik. And the lesson from this perek is, the primary lesson of this perek, which we just finished, is that Hashem tells us, Va'aseli matamim. Hashem turns to Yidden and says, I want you to make for me delicacies. And Hashem says, there are two types of delicacies. We spoke about this before Pesach. There's the sweet foods, and then there's the savory foods. And Hashem likes both of them. So in a general sense, the tzaddik is the one who provides the sweet foods, and we are the ones who provide, I'm making assumptions, I guess, but everyone's sitting around the table. Maybe there's some tzaddikim over here, but I guess Torah al Reif to Dabar, I'm talking about to the most of, I hope I didn't offend anyone here. But and we provide the tart, the spicy, the hot, the pickled, that's in general, but also in our own Aveda, we have both of those areas. And yes, it is our goal, by the way, that more and more of the food that we serve Hashem should be sweet. It's definitely a goal that we have. That we should, in other words, that this area, I'm not struggling anymore in this area. In this area, I have a geschmack. So Tanya, today I'm struggling in davening. I would like to grow my spirituality to the point that I actually appreciate davening. I wake up in the morning and I'm excited about it. I'm still going to struggle. There'll be another year in which I'll struggle. Or maybe my struggle will be within davening, to daven on a higher level. But we're constantly trying to, but at the same time, we should know that Hashem loves the sweet stuff. But those areas in your life where you still happen to be struggling in, don't think that that there's anything defective in that avodah. To the contrary, Hashem appreciates that also. And that is really the overarching lesson of our perek. Life is about struggling. embrace that and appreciate that. Don't discount the value of your struggles. Don't think that your struggles are a nuisance. Don't think that they're just getting in the way of your service and understanding how much Hashem appreciates that. And that's really what this perek is all about. And that concludes this perek, which talks about when a person is upset about who they are. Remember, in the perek Chavav, chapter 26, we spoke about a person who's upset because of what they've done. And today this perek was about who you are. You have to realize who you are, in other words, and the various struggles that arise because of your character and your nature, which, by the way, Hashem gave you. That's not something to be upset about. To the contrary, you can be happy about your struggles and happy about your character, understanding that they are giving you the opportunity to serve Hashem. And with that, we concluded Perek Chav Zayin, and now we will move on to Perek Chav Ches, chapter 28. Perek Chav Ches is also going to talk about a person who is bothered by thoughts which are inappropriate, which is really what we started chapter 27 about. But chapter 27, which we just finished, Perek Chav Zayin, is talking about when a person has inappropriate thoughts or temptations, stamazai, during the day, while at work or involved in whatever worldly affairs. Perek Chav Ches says, what if these thoughts are disturbing your service of Hashem, and specifically learning and davening, and especially davening? And when we're learning and davening, we're talking about inappropriate thoughts. So the word inappropriate here takes on a different form. Because anything, any extraneous thoughts while you're davening is inappropriate. If you're thinking about business, that's inappropriate. And what if a person is davening? I say, what if? This is something I think which we can all relate to. And thoughts are entering your mind. And you're having a difficult time with it.
Talking about random thoughts too. Random.
Yeah, you're having a hard time focusing or concentrating.
That can happen all day long. People walk around with random thoughts.
That's correct.
Very difficult to control that.
Yeah, but during davening, it's a problem.
Because you could daven, then a random thought that comes from the outside enters your mind.
And that's a problem, because you're trying to focus on davening. Imagine you're having a conversation with your wife, and every 2 seconds you're getting distracted and something. I mean, we're talking to Hashem. So we're not here talking about prayer, davening issues. We're here talking about simcha and atzvus, about the happiness and depression. So we're not talking here about. It's not about. Oh, you have this problem. This is not a book of advice. Oh, here, if you have this problem, here's advice. We're very specific and focused on what we're talking about. We're talking about a person who is unhappy or unable to be happy, and different things that bring to unhappiness. One of the things that causes a person, again, a serious person, a spiritual person, to be unhappy is machshava zaras during davening. Why are we upset? Why would a person be upset by these thoughts that enter his or her mind during davening? Why is it so upsetting?
Because you're not connecting with Hashem, you're not having kavana at that second.
Okay.
It's inappropriate.
Anything else?
But just the analogy that you gave to talk to your wife. And then.
By the way, when you say it's inappropriate, it's not your fault. It's not your fault that a thought enters your mind.
How do you control that?
You can't. It would seem that you can't.
You feel guilty because you're not where you should be.
Because
you're not where you should be. Your mind's not where
you're not. Your mind's not where you should be.
So far, I don't see why we can't apply the answers that we already gave.
Very good. What answer should we apply over here? So when I am at work, or when I am cooking supper, or anything of that sort, and a thought comes to my mind, I can be very, very happy that, wow, here I am at work, and here I am busy making supper, and now that I have this thought that entered my mind, so I have the opportunity to do a mitzvah. That's very... But right now, when I'm davening, I'm not looking for mitzvah opportunities. I'm doing a mitzvah. I'm davening. And moreover, this is compromising the mitzvah that I'm currently doing. This is compromising my davening. If If I'm middle of cooking and an inappropriate thought enters my mind, so if I have a tiny perspective, I should be jumping with joy. Why? Because until now I was cooking, and now I'm doing a mitzvah, I'm pushing out of my mind. So in the middle of my mundane kitchen, suddenly I have a mitzvah opportunity. Thank you, Nefesh HaMahamis, for giving me the opportunity to do a mitzvah. But when I'm davening, I'm not looking to do mitzvahs. I'm davening, I want to daven, I want to connect to Hashem. And I'm not able to. I want to connect to Hashem and daven, I want to communicate, and I'm having difficulty. That's why that answer doesn't, you want me to be happy that I can't daven properly? That I'm having difficulty with it? Okay, later on, either today or next week, we'll go a little deeper into why this is such a, why it's so bothersome. In other words, why it's such an impediment to happiness. And also, this peirik will expand. It starts off talking about thoughts during davening and disturbing thoughts during davening, but the lessons from this peirik are going to be much larger in terms of the life lessons that we could take and how they preclude the idea of sadness. Let's do insight. Peirik Chaf Ches. Vafilu im lefim lehuri taivis, even if these thoughts, these temptations enter one's mind, and v'shar machshav azaris, and understand any extraneous thoughts fall into one's mind, b'shas ha'avoida while serving Hashem b'teira b'tfilah b'kavana, with teira or davening b'kavana, so machshav azaris, to have a machshav azara, you have to have kavana. If you're not having kavana, then it's not a machshav azara. You're just mumbling the words. We're talking about a person's obviously is trying to focus on davening and trying to focus on the meaning of the words and is having difficulty. So the first thing the Alter Rebbe says, before the Alter Rebbe is going to talk about the perspective that we should take towards these thoughts, in other words, the deeper understanding of this, the first thing the Alter Rebbe has to tell you practically, what should you do when a thought falls into your head? Al Yashish Lev Aleihem, the number one thing you have to know is don't pay any attention to that thought. Just immediately
push them away.
Push it away. How do you push away a thought?
Let it float.
What?
You let it float.
By what?
You let it float.
You let it float. No, that's not, that doesn't push it away.
It's the opposite.
Block.
The only way to push away the thought is to focus your thought on something else.
Exactly. And that's why, by the way, davening from a siddur inside is very important. Even if sometimes you want to close your eyes, you want to see a little bell pep, but when a thought, and when you get distracted, the best thing that you can do is find a place in the siddur and look in, focus on the word, because it's a way of channeling the mind on the words and thinking about what you're saying. But don't try to struggle with the thought.
But you have to stop for a moment. Beginning of a random thought that comes in, because you just can't say words. You can't read further on when the thought enters your mind.
Why not?
You have to stop.
Why not? Just don't think.
And what are you doing when you're stopping?
To refocus yourself on.
There's an experiment about a pink elephant or elephant. They did a thing, like if you tell a person don't think about an elephant, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, they say whatever you do now, do not think of the color yellow.
Or something, and impossible to do that. In other words, in trying to push a thought out of your mind by saying I shouldn't be thinking about it, it's bound to fail. You can't fight a thought. You have to replace it. And you replace it with weiter. Move on in davening. Don't fight the thought. And there's another thing that you shouldn't do, which is that you start getting down on yourself and you're like, why am I thinking about this? I should be davening. I should be focused on it. It's so important to daven. This thought is so silly. Right? I think we all know these internal... No, that's not the way. As Alter Rebbe will say later, also, when you wrestle with someone who's muddy, you become muddy. When you wrestle with the thought, you're becoming dirtier by wrestling with the thought. Don't pay it any attention. The thought enters your mind. The moment that you realize, because there's always that moment when my mind's straight, I'm somewhere else. You look back and you sit there, which word am I holding by? What does this word mean? What is it? Peseach, Asyadach, Ope, that's it. Move past it. Do not Do not pay to any. Do not pay any attention. Do not fight it. Do not argue with it. Just move on. So that's the number one thing we have to know, is practically speaking. What do you do when a thought comes into your head during davening? The moment that you become aware of it, because sometimes, you know, sometimes you catch it right away. Sometimes it takes you 10 seconds before you, move on. And now the Alter Rebbe is going to negate something which is brought down in Sifrei Kabbalah. And also the Baal Shem Tov talks about this. And the Alter Rebbe, in an unusual move, is going to negate something. Usually the Alter Rebbe tells us what to do. And here the Alter Rebbe is going to tell us what not to do. And that is, again, there's a Kabbalistical concept, which is also, again, discussed by the Baal Shem Tov. You've seen in the works of the Baal Shem Tov, which is called Halaas HaMidos. Halaas HaMidos means elevating Midos, elevating the emotions, the feelings. Every thought that comes into our mind is sourced in an emotion. Every thought. Sometimes it's more obvious and more direct. So for example, if I'm thinking about something that I fear, or same thinking about something that I love, or I'm thinking a thought of jealousy, for example, and all the, in other words, it's a direct, you can look at the thought and say, okay, I know exactly where that comes from. Sometimes It's a little more further removed, but it's still there. So for example, if I'm in the middle of davening and I think about the work that I have to do today, which emotion is that connected with? It's a little less obvious, right?
Yeah.
But why am I thinking about work during davening? Because it's important to me. My work. Why is it important to me? Is my work important to me because one day I woke up and I had this cerebral moment and this brilliant idea that, you know what, I probably should support my family and make some money and maybe benefit the world, so I'm going to go get a job. No, it's not. We don't get a job because it doesn't start in the mind. Why do we get a job?
Purpose.
What?
We need money.
But why, to everything. Why? Because
feed the nefesh behemoth.
Because you desire the money. So it's a desire. That's emotion, right? And you probably fear losing your job. So that's important to you, because if you can lose your job, that's a big problem. So you fear that. So when something comes in your mind, there is that underlying emotion. Just the question is how far back you have to go. But if emotions are what makes something important to you, think about that, what I'm saying, for a second. Your mind doesn't dictate what's important to you. Your heart does. And you think about the things that are important to you. So therefore, it's just a natural corollary that which you're thinking about is ultimately rooted in an emotion. Okay, now we're in the middle of Sfir So'emer, and it's actually an entire process of trying to, you know, dig into our emotions. Where are our emotions? How are our emotions? And trying to make them better. But the reason why we're digging into our emotions as we go towards Matan Torah is because ultimately are my emotions, what I like, what I don't like, what I fear, and what I'm jealous of, all these different emotions that I have, my pride and whatever, these are all represent the most important things to me. And they dictate my life. My emotions dictate my life. Halaas HaMidos means that if I catch myself during, you know, thinking something, so I say to myself, okay, what is that underlying emotion? Let's say it's love. Let's say I'm middle of davening and I'm thinking about my dinner reservation tonight in a restaurant. So I think, and where does that come from? That comes from my desire for steak.
Pleasure.
Desire for pleasure. Okay. So right now, maybe in a subconscious way, sometimes it's more conscious. Sometimes when you're thinking something, the feeling, you're more conscious of the feeling. You're feeling it. Like if you're thinking about something which you're openly, again, distasteful or fearful or something you like, so then you can feel the feeling. But sometimes the feelings are more buried. But the fact that that thought is going through my head means that midah is activated. Because if that midah wasn't that emotion, that feeling wasn't activated, I wouldn't have that thought. So I have a feeling activated over here. That's wonderful. My feeling of desiring pleasure has been activated. What's the greatest pleasure that there is? Torah. Relationship with Hashem. Let me think about that. Let me take a moment. I'll think about Torah, about relationship with Hashem, and how much pleasure that is, and how much greater of a pleasure that is than having a piece of meat. And then what I'm doing is, I'm not changing modes, I'm channeling. I'm channeling that emotion which has already been activated within me in a positive direction. Because once an emotion is activated, it's more easily channeled. We all know that, right? That if you're sad about something, and then you hear bad news, Chas v'Shalom, it's very easy. The mood just extends itself to the next thing. And the same thing is obviously true in the other way. When you're happy about something, and then something else happy comes up, so the emotion feeds off itself.
The ripple effect.
Right. So here also, once the emotion is activated, again, either consciously or subconsciously, but even if it's subconsciously, it has been activated. So I would like to take that activated emotion and not waste it. I don't want to waste that energy. The thought that I'm having is an indication that there's energy flowing within me. I want to channel that. And that's called Halo Asamidas. And again, in Kabbalah talks about it, the Baal Shem Tov talks about it. Says the Alter Rebbe, don't. Don't do Halo Asamidas. Instead, do exactly what I told you to do, the Alter Rebbe says. Just move away from the thought. How do you move away from the thought? By moving on to the next words in davening. Don't try Halo Asamidas. Let's do this inside. The Gam, moreover, and I'll tell you, uses very strong words. Al yihi shayta, don't be a fool. Don't be an idiot. Lasik b'halo asamidois shalamachshav azara, to engage in trying to elevate that, the midah which underlies, that emotion which underlies the machshav azara. Kidnoida, as is known. In other words, apparently the audience to whom the Alter Rebbe was talking to were familiar with this concept of Allah Samidas. I don't know, if the Alter Rebbe was writing Tanya today, maybe he wouldn't write this in, because why would he tell us what not to do if we wouldn't think about doing it in the first place? But apparently when the Alter Rebbe wrote Tanya, he was talking to an audience who were familiar with this concept. So the Alter Rebbe had to disabuse them of this notion of Allah Samidas. Why? Halah Samidais is only for tzaddikim, not for a beinonim. Only a tzaddik is supposed to do Halah Samidais. No, that raises the obvious question.
They don't have this problem.
Tzaddik doesn't have machshava zaris in the first place, right? They don't have anything that everything is right. So vayter inside. Because tzaddikim, they don't have their own machshav azaris, ki mishal acherim. The machshav azaris they have are from other people. It's a scary thought. That a tzaddik experiences the machshavas of the people in his or her proximity.
Meaning?
Exactly that.
He knows what you're thinking about.
It's more than knowing what you're thinking about. He experiences those thoughts.
But they could be very bad, could be negative thoughts. Could affect them very bad.
I just said that it's scary. It is.
Especially what he thinks about you.
Forget about him thinking about you, he's thinking your thoughts.
He knows what you think.
Yeah, it's deeper than knowing. He's experiencing it. He's experiencing it.
I don't want to be a tzaddik.
Sure, right. You don't want to be a tzaddik. I
know,
I thought you were going to say you don't want to be near a tzaddik.
That's it.
You see about the Rebbe all the time. You see some of the videos where he answers the people that are just talking to him on the phone. He knows what they're calling about even before they say it.
So by tzaddikim, the fact that they're able to do that, to be able to...
Read your mind?
Yes, because they're experiencing your thoughts. To understand, a thought is a spiritual thing. If your spiritual receptors are very fine-tuned, you just experience other people's thoughts. I mean, there are multiple stories. I mean, about tzaddikim.
There are thousands of people out there. How could you experience all this simultaneously?
Sorry?
There are thousands and thousands of people in the community.
Okay, that's a technical question, and I'm afraid I don't have the answer for you yet. One day.
Yet. Yeah. Yet is the key word.
If you turn to page Kuf Mem Zayin for a second, which is opposite of page 292. three lines in the top. It says, "V'chein kasav b'sefer asar ma'maris." The sefer, Kabbalah sefer called asar ma'maris. It's written there. Sha'avir gan eden mispasha sabav kaladam. The aura, the ear of gan eden, is around every single person. V'nirshamim ba'avir zeh, and in this ear are etched kol machshavisa v'diburav hatovim, all his positive and good thoughts and speech b'toyra b'avedas Hashem. V'chein lahepech hasasham, the same as the opposite way. Nirshamim ba'avir mispasha b'gehenim, and the aura of Gehenim that surrounds a person, savakaladam, all the bad thoughts and the bad things a person has said. So a tzaddik has an antenna which pick up the thoughts of the people around them. Yeah?
Is this also connected to that story that one of the rabbis got a disease or whatever blues from the veil of a chassid?
No. I don't think so. I don't know how it is by other chassidim, but in Chabad, especially in the earlier years, people didn't want to be so much around the Rebbe. It was scary. And I mean, this is a part of the reason. When you realize that you're standing in the presence of someone who's your open book, it's not, it's... And I remember this as a bacher. It was daunting when you had to pass by the Rebbe, whether it was to receive a kashal bracha or to receive a sefer, receive a dollar. It was, you realize that you're standing in front of someone and everything about you is just open. It's very nerve-wracking, to say the least, you could say. And you always had the people, like you see the different videos, or pictures of the Rebbe, you see like someone's holding the door open for the Rebbe to come in and hiding behind the door. It's like, there was a busha. There was definitely a busha. What's the word of busha? The word embarrassment is not the...
Being ashamed.
And it should be that way. When you're in front of a tzaddik, you have to realize that what's going on. But the bottom line is, says Alter Rebbe, tzaddikim have to contend with machshav v'zaris that are not their own. So how does the tzaddik contend with them? So this is what the tzaddik does. The tzaddik identifies the emotion. And what I'm assuming is that it also helps the person who's having that machshava and redirects, rechannels the underlying emotion into a place of kedusha. A tzaddik can do that. Avol says the Alter Rebbe, but mi shenayif alei mishalai, someone whose machshava zaris are his own machshava zaris. Yebchinas harash beliboi, that come from the evil within one's own heart. Bechal asmali, the left side. How exactly do you plan on lifting up that thought? How do you plan on elevating it? When you yourself are below. You know, when you pick someone up, you have to be, you know, you can't, you know, we're going to elevate that emotion. I'm down here and I'm going to push it higher. It doesn't work that way. The tzaddik, because he's on a high level, so therefore he can rechannel that emotion and bring it to where he is, which is in a holy place. By you, your machshava zara comes from where you are, and that's from a low place. How exactly are you rechanneling it? You're thinking about the work, you're thinking about the stake. That's where you are. That's the level. That's what matters to you. You won't be able to rechannel it to a different place because the desire for davening, a relationship with Hashem, is that's the desire of a tzaddik. That's not something which is by you as real as your work or as your whatever else that thought is going to be. So therefore, again, Halas Amidais is very nice, but that's for tzaddikim. Why? Specifically because they don't have the thoughts. That's why they're able to elevate it. Because they themselves aren't shayichtit. Yeah. That's why they're able to channel it, because they themselves are really removed from such types of thoughts. On the other hand, a person who actually has those thoughts, for you, there is no Halas Amidais, just move past it. So that is what you're supposed to do. But now we have to gain perspective. So I have the thought, and I'll push it away. I'm not going to dwell on it. But how do I view my davening? Is my davening a flawed davening because of these thoughts? Am I a flawed person because of these thoughts? What's the perspective we're supposed to take towards these thoughts? And that's what we're going to talk about, Mirtz Hashem, in the coming week. Shabbos, everyone.